future. It takes pure human grit and creativity to create the possible future. I think one of the most interesting current inquiries that I'm engaged in has to do with communication, and specifically the distinction between, I'll call it traditional communication or a traditional communication paradigm, which technically might be referred to as dialectic, and a less apparent option, which would be called dialogic, or a paradigm that's got a very different structure and a very different intention with it. In a dialectic paradigm, you're really talking about two different views or two different ideologies or two different paradigms, and you're trying to reconcile those differences. And it's kind of like working in an either-or context. It's trying to get to the right answer, or it's trying to get to some point of agreement. And that's the context or the framework of communication that almost all of us have. Like, what's the point and where are we trying to get to? And the sooner we can get there and the more quickly we can reach an agreement, that's the objective of the communication. Dialogic, on the other hand, which was a term that was brought into existence by a Russian philosopher in the early part of the 20th century called Mikhail Bakhtin, really is a different view. It says that dialogic communication is not about getting to a resolution. It's about opening something up. It's about allowing two different points of view to be equally valid and coexist. It's the kind of communication we have where we're creating something together. If you were looking at the idea of co-creation, for example, it's almost essential that there be a dialogic framework of communication for that to be effective. Dialogic may be commonplace in some cases when two people come together for no particular point and then discover whatever they can create together. Maybe even if a first date might even be an example of that. But what this begins to open up also is the awareness that communication, at least dialogic communication, and relationship are centrally interrelated. That if I don't have a trusting, open, confident relationship with you, or if I'm trying to dominate you in our relationship, then it's never going to be dialogic. It's always going to be dialectic. It's always going to be about me trying to get you to do something or agree with me, and in that kind of a relationship, one of us is going to be senior and one of us is going to be junior. There's not going to be the kind of equality that you need to have in a truly dialogic or co-creative kind of relationship. Let me give you a specific example. In business organizations, one of the most important activities of human resources is recruiting. Now, in recruiting, typically we have an applicant who's presenting a resume with information and background and experience, speaking to a recruiter or somebody in the organization who's looking for someone to do a particular job. And there may be several people involved in this process, but basically all of the conversation is aimed around trying to figure out the answer to the question, is this person right for this job? And the practices of recruiting often involve the company challenging the person's experience to see if it's legitimate and if it's real and if it's grounded and if it makes sense in terms of that, what that company thinks they're looking for. Likewise, the person that's applying is obviously trying to look as good as they can, present their best face, and conceal anything that might put their application at risk. I would say most companies understand that that model or that process of recruiting is marginally effective, if at all. That is to say, it ultimately comes down to a judgment and a kind of high-risk decision that this is the right person for the right job. Then when the person comes to work, there's going to be some period of time where he and or she becomes more authentic, and the company also now begins to reveal more about the nature of the work and the nature of the job, and it may or may not work out. If it doesn't work out, it's a very expensive mistake because it takes a long time for that person to leave, either because they voluntarily quit or because the company terminates their employment. Also, it's a situation in which there's not an alignment between the applicant and the company about what's the job really coming in. There's a description, but the description is not the same as the work or the purpose for what the work is being done. We did a project in which we challenged the company to start doing the interviews in a dialogic context. That is to say, let's assume that the applicant's resume is accurate and legitimate. Let's not try to fill a slot. Let's present the person with an issue of what are we trying to do here. We're trying to get new customers, we're trying to deal with a big problem area, but let's instead present our concern and the intention that we're looking for in hiring someone, and then not try to predefine the job, but instead ask this person to engage in a conversation with us so that we're now co-creating the job together, so that the dialogue is not trying to see if there's a fit, but the dialogue is now trying to say, how could we create something together that would take care of this intention or this concern? When you looked at it that way, suddenly we have a person that, if he's the right person, owns the job coming in the door on day one. Secondly, if there is a mistake, it can usually be cleared up fairly quickly just through simple and straight communication. Thirdly, you end up with probably more than the company expected if the company was left to try to define a particular function based on history or based on some kind of a predefined job performance or job description format. We put this into practice in a particular company that was looking for a senior sales representative. And he had already been interviewed in the traditional way by four or five people in the company. The general manager elected to use this dialogic approach, and he shared that it was a remarkable revelation because he suddenly realized that he was no longer trying to come to a conclusion. He was simply having an ordinary conversation with a person. There was a lot more emphasis on just being together and connecting and looking at the particular problem that the company was trying to solve, and got an enormous amount of insight into the individual interest, in his priorities, his values, and at the same time, the general manager was able to even become more clear in terms of what he was really looking for as someone that he could work with to deal with this issue. Now, at the end of that interview, which took maybe 30, 35 minutes, it was very obvious to both individuals that this was not a fit. And so the person that was the applicant left without feeling rejected, and the person, the general manager, was clear that this was not the right person. And when he then talked to the other people that had previously interviewed him, all of whom had said he was the right guy, they realized that they just simply saved an enormous amount of grief by taking up the time and the energy and the effort to both train this individual in the company, but also to invest him in conversations and relationships with customers in a way that at the end of the day would not have turned out satisfactorily for either. So dialogic is a paradigm of communication. It's a different mindset. It's a way we can begin, and this is the most important point of this thing, we can begin to design our organization and our organizational practices so that we can coordinate our differences rather than have to keep communicating in order to try to get us to agree. Most of the conversations and most of the meetings in organizations are looking for agreement. Dialogic says, let's not worry about agreeing with each other. Let's learn to stand in each other's shoes. Let's learn to generate a way of listening and a way of speaking and a way of relating that allows us to generate a world that can acknowledge and validate our differences, not force us into having to agree. We do have to be aligned in our commitments, but we do not have to agree on anything. And the more we can begin to build this distinction into organization and organizational practices, I believe the more power and possibility we'll be able to generate in our world.